Hey, this is Mike from the Graphic Novel Show. Are you interested in starting and running your own podcast? Well, you know, this is the second one that we've done. We used to do a different one, and we decided to start this one. And last time we used Anchor, and you know what? We decided to go back with Anchor again because they are the easiest way to make a podcast. They give you everything you need in one place for free. You can do it right from your phone or on your computer. Anchor gives you creation tools that allow you to record and edit your podcast so it sounds great. You can do that right from your phone. That's quite amazing. They'll also distribute your podcast for you so it can be heard everywhere, like Spotify, Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, and many more. You can easily make money from your podcast with no minimum listenership. Now, what you need to do is go download the Anchor app or go to anchor.fm to get started.
Parker and I use they, them pronouns.
Hi, I'm Mike, and I use he, him pronouns. And this is
the Graphic Novel Podcast.
Welcome to this week's show. We're a weekly show where we discuss graphic novels, zines, and other comics, and we throw in a bit of real life.
We might talk about queer issues, race issues, death, relationships.
Every Friday, you can get a brand new episode. And if you like the show, we'd love it if you went on Apple Podcasts and gave us 5 stars, or on Spotify or YouTube, any place that you listen to the show, and rate us.
Subscribe to this podcast, and it will show up right in your feed the moment it goes live. So we'll be sitting there and waiting for you when you're ready for listening. Also, make sure you share with your friends, because that is how we make this podcast grow.
You can interact with us on Twitter, Facebook, and Insta. And if you want, you can leave us a voice message at anchor.fm/graphicnovelpodcast.
We might play your voicemail on our next episode.
That's right. So how's it going, Parker?
It's going really good.
It is. It's going good. Another beautiful day in the neighborhood. Summer is here. Happy summer.
Oh my God, it is summer.
It is. Summer is here. And yeah.
I wish I could go out and enjoy it a little more.
Yeah, you will eventually. But everything's going good. We've got a good show. We've got some news. A lot of stuff going on in the comic book world. And got a good book. It's still, happy Pride still.
Happy Pride.
This is our last Pride month episode.
And in case you haven't heard, Black Lives Matter.
Black Lives Matter.
And they will always matter.
And we will say that as over the next few weeks, we'll be throwing in some queer and black and everything books. We got a whole bunch of, and people of color too, a whole bunch of different books. We got like 7 or 8 books to review. So we're good for like the next 2 months.
We say that all the time. And you know what's funny is that we don't ever... We don't ever come to, we never get to the point where we're like, oh, we need to buy some more books. We always have a ton to read.
We've got a lot of books. I still have books.
Yeah, from last year when we started the podcast, we have so many. Yeah, there's still books on that bookshelf downstairs
that we haven't read. I've read.
Oh, you've read most of them, but we haven't reviewed them yet.
No. But yeah, we got a lot of new stuff. Got 1 or 2 more coming too. So we got a lot of good stuff. Next couple months are going to be great through the whole summer. Pretty much going to have a lot of good books.
Yeah, I'm excited.
Yeah. So anything else going on?
No, don't think so. No.
All right.
No, I don't think so. Not that I absolutely need to share, I guess. What about you? I didn't even ask how you're doing.
Yeah, I'm fine.
Oh, good.
All right. This week in the comic news. First off, Comics TV, my old TV show from the 90s. All of the episodes have been uploaded to YouTube.
Woohoo!
It's comx-tv.
It was a big feat.
It was a pain in the butt.
You spent hours.
All the episodes I have are up, and there are people. Eventually, I'm going to go through, and I'm going to list all the books, so they'll be searchable then. But there are people that are finding the shows and
finding books of theirs that I reviewed back in the 90s. And it's pretty cool. They're leaving comments. Feel free. It is YouTube. All right. So multiple things going on. First off, as the Me Too movement and all of these related things are going on, the comic book community, females primarily.
Women.
Women are coming forward and feeling enough, brave enough finally to...
I don't even know that it's bravery so much as it's just time. I mean, they are absolutely brave.
Well, some of it is because some of them are afraid they're going to lose their careers and a lot of stuff. It's dominated by white men.
They're absolutely brave for sharing the story. But my point just being that it's time for change to happen. And yep. I mean, there are some amazing women out there who are finally speaking their truth. And nobody owes anyone their stories. There's more stories out there than we could even begin to count.
No, and I'm not going to name them all or the females or
women.
The women. I'm sorry.
I just hate it when you say female. It's like so.
Okay, the women, and their attackers, abusers, whatever they want to be.
We don't care what they want to be. Okay. This is what they are. Yeah. They're abusers.
There's a lot of them.
Predators.
Predators. And that was one of the big ones. It was about these people grooming, you know, young potential creators. When they're in their late teens or early 20s, you know, newbies to the industry and stuff, and taking advantage of them. And sometimes it wasn't sexually, but it was just doing a lot of things that were inappropriate and wrong. And another one, Charles Brownstein, he was the executive director of the Comic Book Legal Defense Fund. And I remember this back in the 90s when we did our TV show, because they... there was stuff going on back then, and I think that might have been when it was created. And they would help creators that got into trouble with, you know, being sued for various different reasons.
Oh, that's right. I remember you talking about that before.
Yes, and apparently there's been talk of this this guy going back to at least 2006, accused of sexual misconduct, and he's still been the executive director. But they have now accepted his resignation, which is good. A lot of other ones, Dark Horse Comics and other ones, they are dealing with creators who they are no longer working with. And there's just so many of them, I can't even think of them all.
That's one thing that's been great about Twitter, is that it's out there. You know, it's like you can't ignore it. It's out there for not just you to see. It's not like some little complaint. Not even little, but it's not some complaint in HR that you know, you and HR know.
Yep.
These women have been brave enough to put it out to the entire world. And so then all these people can put pressure on companies like Marvel and Dark Horse. Yep. and make sure that the women that are working for them are protected, because there's a reason that it's such a boys' club, you know?
Mm-hmm. Oh, definitely. They controlled everything. And, you know, that's the way it's been forever. And a lot of these, one of the women, their accounts, they were afraid to say something.
Of course.
Because they were in a van and something took place, and they were afraid to say something because the other people in the van, she assumed they would just laugh it off, like, oh yeah, we know, you know, that kind of shit.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. If you don't know the people around you are safe. I mean, fuck, for all she knew, they would all help him.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So yeah. So there's a lot of stuff going on. There's a lot of creators who are hopefully being canceled, who are going to be dropped by everybody. And you know what they'll probably do? They'll all probably go over to the Comicsgate side and all become part of that
probably
piece of shit group over there.
Yeah.
All right. So the 2020 Oregon Book Award winners are out. And
do you have any applause sounds there? Woohoo!
You know what? I don't.
You need to do that.
Yeah.
Get on top of that.
Why don't I have that? I don't know.
It's the first time you've been wanting to use it. So
yeah, I don't know.
Obviously, we don't have that beginning of need, but we've talked about award winners before. So.
Yeah, I know. We needed to get that. So the award for graphic literature goes to two Portland residents, Greg Means and M.K. Reed, for Penny Nichols, a book that we had read.
Oh, yeah.
tongue-in-cheek tale about a very amateur effort to make a slasher effect. It's hilarious ode to creativity, the can-do spirit, and friendship. So that was cool. The other thing, I had something, but it's gone. But I know what the story is. The Eisner Awards, which is one of the biggest award ceremonies in the comics industry, which takes place at the San Diego Comic-Con. Apparently, there was some type of website malfunction, and everybody has to redo their votes.
Oh, my God, really?
Yep, everybody has to re-vote because something happened, and it became a mess. And they decided,
How does that happen?
I don't know if somebody was able to hack it and then affect the, affect the voting.
Interesting.
Yeah. So
those things aren't that easy to hack.
Yeah, I don't know.
And what would be the point of that?
I don't.
I bet it wasn't a hack. It was just somebody.
Somebody
fucked something up. I don't know what it could have been.
Probably.
Why? What would be the point of hacking that?
Just I don't know. I didn't read the whole article.
Unless it was like Comicsgate people who just hate the mainstream people. I don't know. I don't know.
Let me see if I can find it because I was saving it, but
it just seems odd.
We've got several books that we were sent also that we have to get to.
What do you mean?
Another person sent us a link.
Oh, okay.
But yeah, we've got several. Let me just look for the Eisners again because I know there's Eisner Awards.
Da-da-da.
Talk about something for a moment.
You know, I'm really bad at coming up with things to just talk about off the top of my head. Sorry, I'm terrible at vamping.
God. You are terrible.
It's like that Office episode where Michael Scott is trying to, you know, talk through something and Dwight goes, vamping. And then Michael freaks out on him for calling out his vamping.
All right, I have no idea. I can't find it. But, here it is. Eisner Awards voting closed abruptly due to voting anomaly.
Anomaly
with investigation underway by the Comic-Con. By Comic-Con.
So it's an investigation.
So there was an anomaly. So somebody was getting more votes than they should have probably for something. So they weren't happy with it. So they decided to cancel the voting and make everybody start over.
Okay, so was it that something just seemed fishy?
Yes, they thought that something was fishy. So we've closed voting and investigating the situation. We'll make an announcement as we have additional information. We're very sorry for the inconvenience.
Yes, they're very
They said
about
that it affected the site hosting, but didn't specify if it affected the voting itself. So I don't know.
I guess it could have been something like it was allowing people to vote multiple times. It could have been as easy as that.
This year it's taken they actually have their own website for the voting. So maybe there was because it's a new site, apparently, so maybe something was wrong. Something didn't work properly.
I don't know. The internet is that way, I feel like. Every time you try and do anything different, it can be completely different than what you expect it to turn out to be.
Yeah, no, exactly. All right, so that is that's all the news, I think, isn't it? Let me just check and make sure that was all on my news. Yep, that's all I've got on the news for this week. Welcome to our Book of the Week. And this week,
we are reading
Gender Queer. Yes.
A memoir by Maya Kogan. 2020 ALA Alex Award winner and 2020 Stonewall Israel Fishman Nonfiction Award Honor book. Very cool.
Yes. And when I first read the book, I saw you in parts of it, and I'm like, this is a good book. I enjoyed it, and I like reading it, so it was good.
I can't wait to hear the parts that you saw me in.
I don't remember.
Well,
Maya Kobabe is graduate of the first ever class in the MFA in Comics program at California College of the Arts in San Francisco. Her first full-length book, Genderqueer Memoir, came out from Lion Forge Comics in May 2019. E is also the illustrator of Tom O'Bedlam, a single issue which was adapted into the Society of Illustrators Comic and Cartoon Art Annual and nominated for an Ignatz Award in 2016. Maya's short comics have been published on the Nib and included in a bunch of different anthologies. All right. Before that, E worked for over 10 years in libraries. E has been self-publishing comics since 2010.
Wow.
Yep.
So, synopsis.
They've been nominated for a bunch of awards.
Oh, yeah?
E has been nominated for a bunch of awards.
For this book? Or for
different stuff.
Okay.
Different things. But anyhow.
So in 2014, Maya Kobe, who uses EM air pronouns, thought that a comic of reading statistics would be the last autobiographical comic E would ever write. At the time, it was the only thing E felt comfortable with strangers knowing about him. Now, genderqueer is here. Maya's intensely cathartic autobiography charts her journey of self-identity, which includes the mortification and confusion of adolescent crushes, grappling with how to come out to family and society, bonding with friends over erotic gay fan fiction, and facing the trauma and fundamental violation of pap smears. Started as a way to explain to Air Family what it means to be non-binary and asexual, Genderqueer is more than a personal story. It is a useful and touching guide on gender identity, what it means, and how to think about it for advocates, friends, and humans everywhere.
Okay, that's quite the intro there.
Yeah.
All right, so Maya's style is somewhat realistic, but cartoony, but somewhat realistic. And it's a full color book, but the colors, it's not like bright colors. They're like a lot of muted pastel colors.
Mm-hmm.
But it's nice. I like it. And I like the way Maya uses, lays out some of the pictures. Sometimes the backgrounds are plain. And it's more about like the person's face and the words and things like that.
Mm-hmm.
But anyhow, I mean, the beginning of the book is about it's actually about them M going to college and A have to write an autobiographical comic, which is the last thing Maya wants to do.
Wait, that's not the beginning.
Yes, that's the beginning. Right here.
Did I skip past it on my... No, I'm all about the childhood stuff.
We're there. Yes, but the very beginning, that's it. It's like, I went to start an MFA in comics, and I have to do an autobiography.
Oh, okay. Right, this is there. Like an intro. Okay.
Yes.
See, now when I pulled it up, I was at the end of the book. Okay, I read this on Hoopla.
So you're going backwards.
So no. I had started at the end. So when I was just hitting the arrow button over.
Oh, you just went. I got back to where the title it said page.
The title page, oh, okay, and so I'm okay, thinking that's the beginning. Okay. Click back.
That's the very beginning, okay. And it's like
yes, and you see him packing the trunk, mm-hmm. And I thought that was funny too, because that was one of the first things that I said when you were talking about him, was that who would think that you could get a master's in comics? Like,
oh,
that,
yeah,
that is so amazing and awesome, yeah, and cool. But it's not something you hear often, and it sounds like he has to explain, yes, it's a real thing. Mm-hmm. I'm not making up my master's degree.
Which is pretty cool, but
yeah.
But it's a master's, so it probably wasn't easy either.
Oh God, no. Yeah, no, gosh, no.
So that's the intro. That's like the prologue, basically. And it's like, here I go to college, and the first thing I have to do is write an autobiographical comic, which is the last thing I want to do,
yeah,
write about myself.
Yeah.
You know, so that's how it starts.
And it's so funny. I feel like society always wants artists to give us this deep personal...
They thing. Do.
They what? Like that is the kind of stuff.
Remember,
I mean,
my
look
course?
At Alanis Morissette, right? Like, well, that was her best album, yes, because it was so, you know.
So many of those are like that.
Everybody wanted to know who that song was about.
Carly Simon. Carly Simon. You know, like, You know, just some of those songs, the albums that just come from pain.
But I find, I mean, I'm one of those people. I love to read about other people's lives. I just love the little details
the comics graphic novel version of people's lives are so much better than just reading text.
Well, yeah. I mean, we're a little partial to graphic novels.
It really though. It's just, you can see things that they're trying to
do. Explain. We just not have an imagination and we can't.
I do. I'm an author. I mean, I am, but.
That's so funny. Oh my God. That's so funny. You're an author and you'd rather read graphic.
You know what? I've thought about taking my fiction and turning it into a graphic.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
You just write too much though.
Yeah. I know.
Your graphic novel would be like,
I'd have to cut some stuff.
Dictionary out. Size.
Anyhow. So, so that's the beginning of the story. And then it goes to Maya's, roots to when they,
childhood.
Yeah, their childhood.
Their childhood. Growing up on a 120-acre property in Northern California with no electricity and no flush toilets. And they were three and a half.
Yep.
And their sister was one.
Right.
I just can't, like, it sounds, okay, I couldn't do no electricity. I couldn't do no flush toilets. I couldn't do that. But growing up on a 120-acre property sounds like heaven to me.
Yeah.
And I'm an atheist.
That's not heaven.
It sounds amazing. I know you'd, I don't, you would live downtown.
Yep,
and
I would.
With, like, I mean, I
without grass.
Yes.
Oh, I would.
You would be so, I mean, I don't necessarily need grass either. I would love to have gardens. I'd love to put wildflowers out.
I understand.
You know, I loved our front yard on Bird Avenue in Buffalo. That was, mm-hmm. that was awesome.
Yes, that was cool. That was.
I would love to have that.
So let's get back to the story.
Okay.
Because we're not going to.
You will never have that.
You'll never have that again. So growing up was, Maya's parents were educated, but kind of hippie-like. And they didn't teach. It was kind of, part of it was just living life. It wasn't really about
well,
learning, reading, writing, arithmetic, you know?
Maya talks about, do they say your parents' names? I don't remember. But her dad is a Waldorf teacher. And so mm-hmm. the kind of Waldorf philosophy is kind of like a learn where you feel pulled, you know, like to where your interests are is where I want you, where we want you to put your
right
to put your energy.
Mm-hmm.
So if you are interested in, you know, if you're not interested in reading, like a talk about not knowing how to read
till they're 11, till they are 11.
Right. And it's, I mean, it's to us, maybe it sounds kind of odd, right? That, mm-hmm. that, a child wouldn't learn to read until
right.
the age 11, but there was the interest wasn't necessarily good enough, but once they found, that book that was like, I gotta read,
mm-hmm.
I have to read this. Then suddenly it all clicked, but the interest wasn't there. And if the interest
right,
isn't there, and
right.
I feel that's a way for a typical education too, is like, I was not interested in certain things. And if I wasn't interested in them growing up, like it just, the stuff went in one ear and out the other. Like I learned it when I had to, and then it was out of my brain.
Right. Right.
You know? And I think that's what's really, honestly, I think that's what sucks about our education in general, is that we don't follow what,
because we have to push people through. We have to push them through like cattle, and they, you know, everybody's
right. Everybody has to fit the standard.
A teacher is graded based on how their students do, and the principal is graded on how their teachers do, and that's where funding comes from.
Right, but if we were giving students the ability to find what their passion is and pour their hearts into these, can you imagine the world that we would live in?
If we spent less on policing and more on education,
I'm all about less on policing
and more on education.
Yeah, why is it that it's so hard to imagine a world where education is better funded than police?
I don't know.
I don't.
We're teachers are paid a good salary. Where there's enough teachers so kids can have one-on-one, you know, not one-to-one, but one-on-one more than, you know, 30 students to one teacher.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of that stuff, it can be done.
Absolutely, it can.
So anyhow, one of the things that as things are starting to take place and Maya is recalling life, third grade field trip to the beach. And they take off their shirt and go into the water. And the teacher's like, oh, put your shirt back on.
Even though they don't have any kind of breasts to speak of, right? They're just a little kid. But yet it was already children are so sexualized that having a flat-chested girl was not okay. Because even though they didn't have breasts, everybody knew that this child will eventually. I mean, it doesn't even make sense. It really doesn't make any sense to me.
Right.
And her father was there and, you know, it sounds like didn't intervene at all, but I mean, I can't even imagine the embarrassment that came from that too.
That's why A took off air shirt. Dad had his off.
Right. So So E was like,
take the shirt off. You know, that's just, you know.
Exactly.
And Maya's parents says, Mom, neither of my parents were interested in enforcing gender roles. So to Maya, it was just, there's no girl kind of thing. It's just, you know, you do what makes you happy.
There were probably family get-togethers at the beach. You know, the whole family probably went to the beach and everybody just took off their clothes and went, you know, like it wasn't something that was a necessary thing to do. And it's just, just makes me so sad to think that that was the.
Right.
I don't know. I hate the way that everything is.
And unfortunately, what got Maya to want to read was J.K. Rowling.
Well, I mean,
a lot of people, you know, and there's that whole conversation.
We didn't know
about
at the time either.
No, I know. But there's a big conversation about if you like the characters and stuff, you can forget about who wrote them.
Well, I mean, you can't forget about who wrote them. That's the thing. You can't forget about who wrote them. But part of it is recognizing the shittiness. And I'm sure Maya knows the shittiness of J.K. Rowling. I don't think that that would be anything that he wouldn't know. But, you know, it's.
But
it is what it is.
Things along the way, like when they got. Their first period.
Oh yes, a traumatic event for plenty of trans people.
And Maya wanted to just not tell anybody and tried to keep it hidden and hid it from other people. And you know, it was, you know, just this thing.
Well, and it's one thing that I will acknowledge is the fact that at least A knew what it was. I think a lot of children get their period and don't know it. And it's terrifying because so many parents don't talk to their children about how their bodies function. And you're doing such a huge disservice to your children. Please, if you have not talked to your children about menstruation, do it. Just do it. Just take the time and just do it because, you know, it's going to happen. And honestly, your little boys too. Talk to your little boys about it too, because a lot of them are going to grow up and have partners who have periods. So it's not going to. It's not, and I mean knowing about what half the population goes through is something that everybody should know, right? Like, I don't know. It's so frustrating to me. But anyway, a lot of people get their periods and have no idea what is going on. Suddenly, there's blood coming out of me. What do I do? You know, and I don't know.
Then Maya, as time's going on, Maya starts to have crushes on people. And Maya is able to remember every one of them. I don't remember. Maybe I do remember most of them. But
I remember a lot of my. I remember, I'd say, most of my crushes growing up.
But then there's the one panel where it was around this time that I looked up gay and lesbian in the dictionary. What am I? 1 week before I started high school, I told a friend about these crushes because some of them were girls. Some of them were boys. So they liked both. They were attracted to.
A liked both.
A liked both.
Uh-huh. Or E liked both. E. Yes. And that's another thing that's so hard, because I remember growing up and having these intense feelings for, and I think we've talked about this on the podcast before, and not recognizing at the time that it was a crush, mm-hmm. but he recognized that it was a crush.
Yeah.
And I mean, I don't know if it was their upbringing that made him realize that it was a crush, because it was like, it wasn't something that was hidden and like not talking. Like, I remember my parents talking about my uncle who was gay and not saying he was gay, and saying that the person living with him was a friend. And so it was kind of like a hush hush thing. Like, if you don't talk about it, then it doesn't exist. And so maybe our family wasn't so much like that, you know?
Right.
So maybe it was something that wasn't scary.
Right.
Even though it's scary. Because if you don't, it's still hard, because you know how society is. Even if your parents aren't that way, there's a time when you are, you know, at school or whatever, where suddenly, you know, society is hitting you in the face. And it's like, oh, I'm not supposed to talk about, supposed to talk about the fact that I have a crush on this person.
Well, there's a friend who Maya confides in, and they say, oh, my mother said that a lot of times, you know, they're just crushes, you know?
Yeah, it's just a phase.
It's a phase, right? But then they fall kind of hard for this one person, and when
E falls,
right? And when A are telling their friend, the friend is like, oh no, and they the friend starts, you know, saying bad things about this person and stuff, and trying to get them.
Oh, the crush.
To push away.
And I mean, I kind of felt like it was a jealousy thing.
It could have been, yeah.
Like, she had a crush on Maya, and
yes,
so.
Yes, yes. Are you still freaking out about being a lesbian? No. But then they're back at Waldorf, and in there, then the only openly gay student starts a queer straight alliance group, and Maya goes to it. You know, and that kind of starts them.
Is that what it was called? Queer Straight Alliance?
That's what he says right here. He says, I want to start a Queer Straight Alliance.
Oh, yeah. Okay. I'm there. Yeah. Which is interesting. I mean, I love
USA.
Yeah. I love that it was called a Queer Straight Alliance. Maybe it was because it was California and they're kind of ahead on things.
Maybe.
My school, I mean, I grew up in the middle of nowhere. My school did not have any sort of, after I got out of school, you would hear about gay straight alliances, but that was never anything that was there when I was in school. And I'm only a few years older than Maya is. So, I mean, it's pretty sad that.
Yeah, but you were in a redneck town. So
I think that was a big part of it, is just where I was growing up. But there's lots of queer kids that I went to high school with who weren't out at the time.
Right.
But into adulthood and with Facebook and, you know, all the, you know, you find out there was actually a lot of queer kids in my class alone.
And it would have been nice to all be able to bond together.
To at least be able to be out.
To be out.
And support each other.
Support. That's what I'm thinking. Yes. To be able to support each other like that.
Because now I look back and there was plenty of homophobic people in my school that I didn't even realize or recognize.
Yeah.
Because I didn't. Most of them. Because you don't know, you know? And especially if you're not, if you can pass as a straight cis person, which I did in school, then it's harder to, or it's easier to just, you know, blend.
Mm-hmm. So, Maya starts going to these meetings and finds out that there are other kids that there are kids that have lesbian moms, and
which was a lot of the kids in the group. I think it said
there were three of them came from families with lesbian moms, and the rest were allies.
Well, and I mean, if you come from a family with
they brought their friends.
They were allies to begin with. If they're part of a queer family, but if they're not queer, then they're allies.
Right. But what's funny is a friend from QSA lent me the Strangers in Paradise series by Terry Moore. Stranger in Paradise, I read a bunch of them on Comics TV.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, yeah. There's this whole queer couple thing. I've actually looked at buying the books, so I might buy them.
Okay.
the graphic novels.
See, that's one of the things that I always missed out on. I didn't I didn't have any of the queer community around me.
Right.
And so I didn't ever, like, I didn't know anything about Strangers in Paradise. I didn't know, really, I didn't have, I had no idea who David Bowie really was. I
mean, right, exactly.
A lot of, I feel like they're so lucky in a way that he got to, you know, have some of this, like the Queer Straight Alliance in high school and stuff, because I just, I didn't get to, I mean, I'm kind of sad that I didn't get to experience any of that.
And there are other things going on. The club morphs into a Lord of the Rings club. Maya's friend actually becomes a member.
Lord of the Rings, which I was never into.
But about,
I've never been into.
They talk about which actors were most likely to be gay and, you know, all kinds of stuff. But
Which you do, I mean, into adulthood.
Yeah.
Into adulthood, but, you but still then, talk about.
But then let's get into some of the things. Apparently people are complaining that Maya does not smell well because Maya doesn't use deodorant. And so people are complaining, and, you know, so they had a problem because the deodorants all gave them rashes and stuff.
Oh yeah, yeah. And I mean, I had that issue last year. All of a sudden, I was all my deodorant was giving me rashes. I had no idea what was going on. But
yeah,
and how scary it for that to happen as a kid too.
Yeah, yeah. You know, and then
you're like, I just don't want people complaining about my smell anymore.
Mm-hmm.
And suddenly now you have to deal with a rash. Oh. Do I want a smell or do I want a rash under my arms?
You know, and here's why you brought up David Bowie, because they learn about learned about David Bowie, and Dad had David Bowie.
And so, Queen. Yes. All of a sudden their dad is introducing E to all these bands. And was it tapes? It was all tapes. It looks like cassettes that he pulled out to show.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think it's great. Have you heard of Queen?
Yeah.
Frank Zappa, Pink Floyd, and the Doors, the Stones, all the Beatles too. I mean, I knew the Beatles from elementary school, concerts.
Oh yeah,
we would
sing
the Beatles and stuff. So I knew the Beatles, but
the Beatles didn't sing queer music though.
Well, no.
David Bowie
was queer,
and obviously Freddie Mercury.
Oh yeah.
But
it's
page
amazing.
61 is where I really saw you.
Oh okay, let me. 61. Oh yeah.
I was 11 or 12 years old. The first time I can remember fantasizing about having a penis.
Yeah.
I was lying fully clothed on a hillside under an open sky. And, you know, and they just, they explain how they masturbated.
E.
E masturbated.
Yeah.
You know, and it's interesting.
Yeah, it's interesting because it's not something that you hear about often, right? Like, I feel like a lot of people, I remember as a child, I didn't ever learn about what masturbation was. Mm-hmm. And so I just assumed that it was penetrative. And I didn't understand that I could figure out my body and figure out what felt good.
Mm-hmm.
And that was masturbation. Like, I just thought it had to be penetrative and that was masturbation.
Right.
Whether it was pleasurable or not, like, it wasn't something that I, you know, could think about. It was just, oh, this is what I'm supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't know why. I don't know if it was like I wasn't comfortable enough with my body to explore it more and be like, oh, this is actually what feels good. But I actually didn't know how to masturbate until I watched porn.
That's terrible.
It's not terrible. And it's probably where a lot of people learn how to masturbate, I would think. No?
No.
I
looked at Playboys.
You looked at Playboys.
That wasn't.
I mean, it must be different though, because you have one part, right?
Yeah. Anyhow.
Okay, I don't know what that means, but so I don't remember exactly the first time that I imagined having a penis, but I did. I have for as long as I can remember. It probably happened around puberty, I would think, that it was something in my head. But it's not, I don't know. It's just something that's in the back of my mind all the time.
So then the a lot of the rest of the story is about how Maya is trying to figure out who
let the dogs out.
Who he is. Because Maya realizes that not interested in masturbation. They feel like they're they feel like they're like half boy, half girl.
And, but not really even.
But not
just
really.
Not.
Just but they don't feel like they should either one or the other.
And when you're when you're assigned female at birth, or assigned male at birth, and you're kind of put into those zones or those boxes, I should say, it feels like you, for a lot of people, you have to stick really rigid with what the idea of the gender norm is. And I think E was really lucky that their upbringing was not so rigid, you know?
Right.
Like, E's parents were not fitting into those gender norms. So it wasn't something that was like stuck, but like E knew that E wasn't a girl, but didn't
exactly like a boy either.
Feel like he didn't feel like he had to go all the way to, I mean, I feel like, I don't know. I'm trying to, because that's where it differs. That's where it differs so much from my experience. My experience, you know, it was different. I grew up with pretty rigid gender roles in my life. You know, both my parents did work full-time jobs, but my mother did all the cooking, all the cleaning, all the taking care of the children, all that stuff, until we were a little older. That was all on my mom. And my dad did the car work or the grass or, you know, taking out the trash or whatever, you know. So the gender roles in my family were pretty strict. And so my experience was that I had to fit into those things. And when I didn't feel like I fit into them, my best alternative was to force myself into them. So from a very young age, I knew that the only way to be a real woman was to get married and to have children. And so those were my life goals. You know, I didn't really have passion outside of that. And while I am, you know, and that shaped a lot of who I was. I wanted to get pregnant and I couldn't get pregnant. It took me almost a year to get pregnant the first time. And it was so painful to me because I was scared that I wasn't going to get pregnant and then I wouldn't be a real woman. And when I had the C-section, I felt like I had failed at being a woman. And you know, I was a failure again at being a woman. And then I couldn't breastfeed fully. I couldn't make enough milk. And so I wasn't a real woman. And so all of those failures just kind of grew and grew and grew. In my head, it was this eternal battle between forcing yourself into a box that you don't fit in. And, you know, I have these check marks, I have these things that I have to do and I have to, you know, I'm not a real woman if I can't do those things. And I know, I mean, I know now that that real women don't all have babies and real women don't all get married and you don't have to have a natural childbirth or a vaginal birth to be a real woman. And you don't have to breastfeed to be a woman. Like that's not something, you don't have to nurse your children at all to be a real parent. But at the time it was just these boxes that I had to check because if I couldn't check them, then I wasn't living up to what I was supposed to be, which I knew I wasn't that in my head, but I was trying to, you know, it's just this constant battle. And so then we had our youngest, and I had a home birth in a tub with no midwife present. And, you know, that was like, yes, I did it. But mm-hmm. that it still didn't yeah. do it for me.
Right.
And I think that and then, you know, I still couldn't make enough milk. I made more that time, but it still wasn't enough. And I couldn't, it was still this battle. And it mm-hmm. was like, okay, but I checked this off. Like I did this thing. Mm-hmm. I did this thing. So, and you know, I was living up to the expectation that I was supposed to. And so I got a lot of support for, and, you know, and more understanding behind, you know, the C-section, and that doesn't change who you are, you know? So I started to kind of unravel things, but then I kind of went a different way and kind of, you know, started to meet people, and they were saying things like, you know, there's lots of ways to be a woman. You don't have to meet these expectations. So instead of realizing that I wasn't a woman, it was like, oh, okay, I can be a woman and still not fit these boxes. And I knew at the time, for a long time, that I wasn't a woman, mm-hmm. but I didn't even hear the word. Like, I think Maya says the first time the word transgender was in our brain was, did he say?
The summer before high school.
Right.
So I noted in a journal entry.
Really early.
2003.
I didn't, the first person I heard about being transgender or knew, I mean, I didn't know him, but Chaz Bono was the first time I had ever heard the word transgender. And that was in 2011. I was already 20 something. So, you know, it wasn't something that I even knew existed. So, I mean, and growing up, I was kind of what you'd call a tomboy, you know? And so, and like I said, I had these things, and like I had this dysphoria around my body, but I just thought it was normal things. I thought, oh, this is how all women feel. All women hate their periods. Mm-hmm. You know, all women hate their breasts. All women hate the way their body looks. And it wasn't really even until after I had top surgery that I realized that happiness, realized the happiness that comes from seeing your body look like. I just thought I didn't like my body, but it wasn't that. I just didn't like my breasts. I didn't get it. And I get it now because the euphoria I get standing in front of a mirror right now, mm-hmm. even not completely healed, the amount of happiness mm-hmm. is just overwhelming. Like,
you are very happy.
I am very happy. But it's so amazing because you don't even like I didn't even realize necessarily what it was. I couldn't mm-hmm. put a pin on it, you know? Mm-hmm. I couldn't figure it out. I just knew that there was something.
But you did, you had an idea because you asked me a few years ago.
It's been a few years. Mm-hmm. And honestly, a lot of it was reading books, mm-hmm. And I mean, comic books too, mm-hmm. Graphic novels. I've discovered myself a lot more through reading books like this. And it's like, oh my God, that's exactly how mm-hmm. I feel. Oh my God, I did that too. I used to pretend I had a penis, mm-hmm. you know, like it's just, you don't think anything of it. And then you know, and then you find out, like talking to people, and I don't feel that way. And it's, oh, I thought everybody did that.
You have mentioned that almost since the time we got together,
right? Which, and did you think that it was strange?
I always thought it was kind of a joke.
Oh,
kind of a joke. You know, yeah. Like I wish I had a penis. You know, I wish I could walk around with, you know, that hanging between my legs, and I, you know, and it hangs, but but it was always, you know,
well, because I always kind of threw it out there jokingly.
Yes, it was part kind of a joke, but I didn't run from it, but I always just kind of wondered. It was like, all right, you know.
Yeah, you think a little bit beyond it.
As years went on, it became, you know, like I think you really do wish you had a penis, you yeah. know. And you know, and now this makes all perfect sense.
Yeah, it all clicks. Yeah. It all clicks. Yeah, it's been an interesting journey. I mean, I just came out as trans last year, and it's just getting it off of your chest. Like I have had suicidal thoughts most of my life, almost every day of my life, from the time probably about puberty. And I don't really tell many people that, but it essentially went away last year.
You didn't tell me most of the time.
Oh, probably not. Why vocalize it? It's just something that you think about in your head. And I mean,
okay, but not everybody does that.
But I don't know that. I didn't know that. I just thought it was something that people did. You know, I just thought it was.
And it's pretty much gone away.
Oh, it's gone. It's completely gone. Good. I can't even tell you the last time I thought about it. Honestly,
good.
Yeah, I mean, it's great. But it coincides completely with coming out.
Yes, yes. As you realized who you were,
I don't know. It's just, I don't know. It's amazing. And
as you said out loud who you were, it wasn't even just doing it. It's like, this is who I am.
Well, and because, I mean, like we talked about recently, like I honestly thought that coming out would mean divorce. I honestly believed, and I had to get to a point. I had said it enough to myself. I knew who I was. I knew who I was for a long time before I told you. Mm-hmm. But right. I had to get to a point where I was
comfortable, right?
Not comfortable, but
willing to
give up, willing to give up the marriage in order to be myself
for yourself. Yes,
and everything that that meant. I mean, well, that would mean you know, shared custody and co-parenting and all the garbage that comes along with that.
And what?
We're not getting divorced.
Didn't have to happen.
I thought you were going to say something different.
Guess what? No, but it did. Surprise!
Yeah, that's the worst favorite story. But I mean, it did have to happen.
Yeah,
because 2 years ago you would have left me if I hadn't taken the path that I took, which was educating you through books and podcasts
and tossing little nuggets at me.
I think that we would be divorced right now.
Maybe not. I mean, forcing me to listen to podcasts while we're driving.
I like how you say forcing.
And that's what you did. You know how it is when you're the driver, you get to choose.
Drive.
on weekends, you drive because I drive during the week. So you like to drive on the weekend.
No, it's really just about the podcast. I just want
it. It probably is, you fucker. Anyhow, I mean, it helps because I learn things, which is what your goal was.
Yeah.
To make me listen, but our children are learning too.
Absolutely.
I just hope our children are smarter than we were, and they don't ever have these feelings because they know what they are, and they can at least talk to us about it.
Well, and I mean, it's not going to be easy. I mean, it's never easy. Our oldest is non-binary but not comfortable enough to come out at school.
Right. Well, of course.
Because there's already that stigma, and we
live in a nice area, but it's still kind of conservative. So, I mean. Yeah.
And
you know, it's tough.
They've told their teacher, mm-hmm. and at least last year, and the principal and the school counselor all know. Mm-hmm. So it's a step in the right direction. But you know, I don't know what middle school, high school brings.
Right.
You know, I haven't looked into yet if they have a queer straight alliance there at the local high school. I don't know. It would be nice.
No, I don't know. Based on what happened. Anyhow, let's get back to the book.
Okay, yes. Enough of our own shit.
Yeah, so Maya's reading a lot. You know, Maya goes from not being able to read to devouring 80 books a summer, you know. Mm-hmm. You know, and they end up, E ends up reading some books that have some tame gay sex scenes in them, which kind of excites them. But sex is not, you know, really something they're interested in. That's not part of who they are.
E-R. Yeah. I'm not asexual, but I found that really interesting to read about. And asexual is so much more complex than I think a lot of people make it out to be. So many people think asexual just means you have no interest in sex or relationships or anything else.
And honestly,
I think Maya was not even sure if mm-hmm. he wanted to have some kind of relationship or not, or if it just wasn't like figuring yourself out first. And I mean, it was interesting to see the way that he handled the people that were interested and, mm-hmm. and
right, you know, right, right. And if you don't know a lot about asexuality, which I didn't know, watch BoJack. Because there's characters on there, and they explain some of that stuff.
Huh? They do.
You can get married. Two asexuals can get married. You don't necessarily, you know, and, you know, it's a lot of different stuff.
That's right. What's his name? Todd.
Todd's asexual. Weird damn show. Like, there's so many topics it covers.
It does cover a lot of things.
But Maya's sister is queer also. So
that's right.
That
I forgot
became
about
a big
that
thing. Yeah, that became a big thing. You know, so there's all kinds of things like
Johnny Weir. I love that.
Maya doesn't want to wear bras and doesn't want to.
E wants to look
how they want to look. E doesn't want to fit into
right. It's about wearing what's comfortable and not what society says you should wear. Yeah. And I am so envious of the person that E are because I couldn't. I mean, even now it's hard for me. And part of it is my body type too. Finding clothes that fit a short, fat person. It's not easy in any department. So, but it has to be, you know, the men's department or the women's department. And it's, I don't know.
Okay. Johnny Weir. I couldn't remember what that was. Okay. I just found it.
I remember watching that Olympics
during the 2010 Winter Games. All my attention was focused on figure skater Johnny Weir. And I was entranced.
Uh-huh. I remember that's I think the first Olympics that we really watched. Oh, yeah. We would stay up until 1 o'clock in the morning watching the Olympics. It was amazing. That year, 2010.
We did.
Yes, you and I.
Oh yeah, that's right. Yes, we did. We were watching it.
Yeah.
I went all out for my costume. I hand sewed a replica outfit. We watched his entire reality TV show.
Oh, this is it. I had no idea he had a reality TV show.
Yeah, but you know, but then the other thing was the pap smear. They the biggest thing that Maya that whole thing being penetrated was something that hurts them.
Yeah.
And physically hurts them.
Yes.
And it's hard.
Yes. And I think a lot of trans, and actually I was just listening to a podcast today. Throwing Shade.
Mm-hmm.
And they had a Dr. Kayla McLaughlin, I want to say. Kayla McLaughlin on talk and she works in I want to say San Diego, but it's definitely California, and she works with trans patients and does she's a physician's assistant, so she wouldn't do like surgeries, I guess, but she, you know, works with trans people, and so she was talking today about pap smears and their gender trans friendly not necessarily just gender clinics, but trans-friendly doctor's offices allow trans men and gender non-conforming people who have vaginas and cervixes to do their own pap smear now.
They can do it at the doctor's office or at home? In the front of the doctor so they can...
No, not in front of the doctor. I don't think it's at home, but you just have to have the Q-tip just has to brush the cervix. And they found, much like, I don't know if you remember when I was pregnant with Isabella, they do a strep test, and you have to test the bacteria to see if you have, if you test positive, because then you have to take antibiotics while you're in labor.
Oh, okay. Right.
So the difference, there's a 90, oh man, I'm going to get these percentages wrong, but I think it's a 94% accuracy when the doctor or midwife, does the test, and only 92% accuracy. So there's only a 2% difference in accuracy between somebody being comfortable and
wait, what was the
touching? 92 accuracy versus 94 accuracy.
Really? When only 2% difference.
Exactly.
And this way they're more comfortable doing it themselves
because they have they have the control. They don't have to be, you know, spread eagle. Somebody else is not penetrating them with a metal speculum. I mean, it's, I can't imagine why anybody wouldn't want it that way. So anyway, she was on the podcast talking about that, and I hadn't heard about that, but I would definitely prefer that. And I mean, I've had pap smears. They aren't as bothersome to me, as lots of other trans people, but I would definitely prefer to, I mean, that is something that I can do. Go to my doctors and bring this information to them so that other trans people who aren't comfortable can maybe go there and then have that offered to them as opposed to having to bring it up. Mm-hmm. Does that make sense?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah. But yeah, so.
So if you're trans and you don't want to have the pap smear done the way it's done, but still want to make sure that you are healthy and that your cervical changes aren't happening, then call ahead and ask if you can do the pap smear yourself.
Yeah, if they're old school, that won't happen.
No, but if you have a trans friendly doctor who understands, and you know, if you present them with the information, I'm sure that you can find some, you know, Google it real quick. I'm sure there's stuff about it, and present them with the information about the accuracy. They may just let you do it. And if it's, you know, I don't know.
Yeah.
Because it's better to go and do it than not. Right. Kayla McGinnis. She's not a doctor. She's a PA. That's not a doctor.
No. Is that who you're talking about?
Yes.
Okay. That's not the same person that you said.
It's not McGinnis. It's McLaughlin. Okay. Kayla McLaughlin.
Okay.
Said that she, now I don't remember.
She said a lot of things.
It was a really good episode. She's been on the show like three times.
I listened to part of it yesterday.
And, but she said some trans people who are taking testosterone don't have to, if they are in monogamous relationships, and not having multiple partners, then they can take, like, because of the way the testosterone changes your cervix, you can take do the pap smear and then like be done with it forever.
Oh, really?
Like, you don't have to keep doing it every 5 years or whatever.
Interesting.
Assuming, you know, you don't have multiple partners and stuff. Which I thought was really cool. So, if that's, you know, if you are trans and traumatized by the pap smears, find a doctor who's willing to work with you and listen to your concerns.
Yeah. So the rest of the book is good as
amazing. I love
Maya's. Maya's trying to figure out, you know, life.
Yes, and there's so much. I mean, we can probably spend hours talking about all the different things,
relationships
that he talks about throughout. Yes, and like buying a vibrator and realizing that's not for me. Mm-hmm. Which, I mean, that's so awesome. I mean, I love the way that he can just, you know, discover trying new things and, you know, not necessarily liking it, being like, okay,
yeah, not, that's like, not for me.
I mean, maybe maybe it's because of the book, and maybe he just didn't, you know, put a lot of the internal struggles in it. It doesn't feel like that, but it feels like there wasn't a lot of like, you know, negative self-talk about what's wrong with me. You know?
Right. They were...
There was a little bit.
He was trying to figure it out.
Right. No, yeah, but there's a difference between trying to figure it out, which, I mean, everybody is trying to figure out who they are, right? And beating yourself down because you're trying to fit into this box that you think you need to belong in. Like, I think he knew that there was no box.
Right. And that's great for Maya.
Great for Maya. Like, yeah, and honestly, the queer people that surrounded through what are you doing throughout the book. I mean, because Air Sister is queer too.
Right.
Anyway, I just thought it was an amazing book, and I could probably spend hours upon hours upon hours talking about
it. I'm sure we already spent 3 hours.
So please, go check it out. Go buy it. Support your local comic book shop.
You can check it out on Hoopla if you get it through a library.
Do we look up E's Twitter or anything?
Maya's
Twitter?
Do not know. I will check. But yeah. You,
Maya Kobabe, thank you for putting your lovely life experience out to the world and teaching people about what it means to be genderqueer. And
yeah.
Asexual
too. Does not look like there is a Twitter account. Might be Instagram or something, but no Twitter account. At least under the name Maya Kobabe. Well,
check out our book. Buy it anywhere you can.
So thank you. We hope that this has been a month between everything going on with Black Lives Matter and Pride and COVID.
Yeah, make sure that you support Black-owned businesses.
Take care, though. Stay safe. Wear your mask. You know.
Happy Pride.
Happy Pride. Black Lives Matter. And until next week, my name is Mike.
And I'm Parker.
And this is
the Graphic Novel Podcast.